Good afternoon, everybody, and thanks for being here today. And I really would like to thank the organizers for inviting me to be here to talk about what I think is one of the most exciting areas of research in our solar system these days, which is, as you saw in the video, this search for a new planet out beyond the orbit of Neptune. I want to try to give you the story of why we think this new planet is there, and to do that, I'm going to have to take you through the history of the discovery of planets in our solar system over the past 200 years. I want to take you all the way back to when there used to be only 7 planets that were known. First there were only 6 planets that were known. The 7th planet, Uranus, was found by accident. It was found by an astronomer who was carefully looking across the sky and noticed that there was a spot in the sky, a star in the sky, that the next night it was in a different place. And he very quickly realized that that must be something in our solar system, not a star. And people started charting it and watching it moving across the sky. And there were arguments even way back in, this is now 1780, there were arguments in 1780. Is this a planet? Is this not a planet? Is this a comet? Is this something else? And astronomers wanted to know, if they were going to call this new thing a planet, they wanted to know if it behaved like a planet. And they knew what planets behave like. Planets go in these nice circular orbits around the sun. And so they wanted to know if it went in a circular orbit, but they had a problem, which was it had just been discovered and it only moved a little bit. So they couldn't tell if it was going in a circular orbit or not. And this continued on for decades. They still didn't have enough information until in about 1820, an astronomer in Paris, Alexis Bouvard, went back and found more pictures. They didn't have pictures, more drawings that had been made of Uranus. And he realized that you could find, here it is. He went back in 1820, he realized that you could find pictures of Uranus that showed it all the way from 1690 all the way up to 1820. He found 100 years worth of, 200 years worth of pictures of data for where Uranus was. And by finding all of those old locations, he realized that indeed it had a circular orbit around the sun. So Uranus was a planet. But he found something else that was interesting. And if you look at this table, you don't have to read all the fine print here, but if you look very carefully at the table up there, there are a bunch of dates from 1690 to 1819, and then there are a bunch of pluses and minuses and pluses and minuses. And all those pluses and minuses were where somebody had found Uranus, but it was slightly ahead of its position, or it was slightly behind of its position where it was supposed to be. And Bouvard in 1820 had found all these and realized they were slightly off from where they were supposed to be. And he did something that he was a theoretical astronomer, a mathematician, and he did something that theoretical mathematicians and astronomers continue to do to this day. He said, look, you know, my predictions don't fit the data exactly, must mean that the data's wrong. This is what astronomers seem to always do. This was a joke, so you guys have to get used to the fact that I'm going to tell jokes and you're supposed to laugh. So let's try this again. Must be the data was wrong. That was good. You guys are not ready to laugh yet, are you? Okay, so it turns out they continued to watch where Uranus was for many years, and it continued to be in the wrong place. And eventually, in 1845, an astronomer also in Paris named Le Verrier, realized that he could calculate why Uranus was in the wrong place. It was in the wrong place because it was being tugged by another planet out there, and he predicted that there should be this 8th planet at the edge of the solar system. He went to the National Academy in Paris, gave his prediction, showed his observation, showed his calculations, showed people where it should be, and they all clapped their hands very nicely, and then they went off to do their own thing. And he realized no one was going to go look for it. No one was going to go look for it because even by 1845. People still didn't quite believe that you could use science and physics to predict where something was, predict something new, like a new planet. He was very frustrated, and he finally had to reach out to astronomers in Germany who went and he told them exactly where to look. They went and looked that exact day that night, and it was exactly where he said it was going to be. This was the discovery of Neptune, which to my mind is still one of the most amazing scientific discoveries of all time. It was a prediction based on the physics of these gravitational interactions, and it turned out to be exactly right. Now imagine what happens. Le Verrier predicts that there's a planet out there. That prediction comes true, and Le Verrier gets very famous very fast. And other astronomers who had not really paid attention to him suddenly realized, oh, I want to be famous. And so they started predicting another planet out beyond Neptune. So they you know, if you could use perturbations in the orbit of Uranus to find Neptune, then maybe you could use perturbations of Neptune to find whatever else was next. So from about 1846 until about 1990, astronomers continued to look at the orbits of Uranus and Neptune, look for perturbations to these orbits, and predict this thing that many of you have heard of called Planet X. Planet X was supposed to be this thing that perturbed the orbit of Neptune. The most famous prediction of Planet X was Percival Lowell, who was so convinced there was a planet out there that he founded an entire observatory out in Arizona in the southeastern United States. He founded this observatory to look for his predicted Planet X. And he hired someone to go look for it, and this was Clyde Tombaugh. Clyde Tombaugh started looking for Planet X, and he took a picture of the sky, and it looked sort of like this. And there it is. Do you guys see it? No? Okay. Well, you can't see it. It's there. This Planet X that he was looking for is really in this picture, but it didn't look like he thought it was supposed to look. Planet X, everybody thought, was going to be massive because it was perturbing the orbit of Uranus or Neptune. And if it were massive, it would take up most of the screen here. In fact, what Clyde Tombaugh found is that there is something in the screen, but you only see it if you come back the next day and take another picture and see it move. Did you guys see it move? Let's try again. Here's the first night. Here's the second night. Anybody see it move? Maybe. Okay, first night. Second night. Yeah, the corner, maybe. Okay, I don't know why, but the fourth time, everybody always gets it. So pay very close attention. I think you'll get it this time. Ready? First night. Second night. There it is. These are the discovery images of Pluto. And this is how Pluto was discovered by Clyde Tombaugh, taking these pictures one night after another, after another, after another, and staring at them and looking for something that moved. Now, he was looking for something that was huge. He was looking for something that was the size of the whole screen in this case, but it was just that tiny, tiny, tiny little dot. And even at the time of the discovery, Clyde Tombaugh was a little bit worried that maybe this was not the big Planet X that he was looking for. But other astronomers were convinced this must be Planet X, and they came up with crazy ideas why it looked so small even though it's huge and massive. My favorite crazy idea was that it looks small, but it has this huge uranium core, and it's surrounded by a liquid oxygen ocean. So it's super massive, but it's all even better. So that liquid oxygen ocean acts like a lens and makes it look smaller. Now that is about the craziest idea that you would have ever heard. And in fact, it's not true that that's the way it is, but it doesn't matter. This is what it said in the newspapers of the day at the time of the discovery. Ninth planet discovered, edge of the solar system. Seen at Flagstaff, all true. My favorite part, the sphere, possibly larger than Jupiter and 4 billion miles away, meets predictions. This is one of the ways that science can sometimes go off on the wrong track before it eventually fixes itself. There was a prediction that there was a giant planet out there, and because there was a prediction of a giant planet, when a small thing was found, people thought this must be the giant planet. It turns out that there is a much more interesting reason why Pluto looks so small. It's not that it has a core made of uranium, and it's not that it's actually something that's as large, possibly larger than Jupiter. Anybody know why Pluto looks so small? Yeah, because it's small, right. It's actually quite tiny. Let's look how big it is. There's that tiny little thing. Let's take a look at how big it really is. Here are the planets. You almost never see this kind of view of the planets because Every time you ever look at a view of the planets, they're always kind of distorted in different ways. But here's a real view of the size of the planets. This is Jupiter here in the background, Saturn here in orange, Uranus and Neptune, the terrestrial planets up there on top. You can even see the little asteroids, the 10 of them that are big enough to see on the screen here. And way down in the corner, if you look really, really carefully, is Pluto. Pluto is tiny. It doesn't fit with the pattern of the rest of the solar system. People didn't really even know what to make of it. Just like at the discovery of Uranus, people weren't quite sure what to call Pluto. But at the time of the discovery, oh, don't tell me my movie's not going to play. It is going to play. Okay. At the time of the discovery, there was nothing else out there. So people just decided to call it a planet. What's even weirder about Pluto, here are the orbits of the giant planets again, Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, Neptune. Let's put Pluto in there. Pluto, here's Pluto. Pluto is on this very, very different orbit from the other planets. It's very elliptical, where the other ones are very round. And what's even stranger is if you tilt all this on the side, while all the planets are in one disk around the sun, Pluto is tilted by about 20 degrees. What we now know, though, is that Pluto is not alone. Pluto, in that region where Pluto is, there are thousands and thousands of other objects like Pluto. Most of them smaller, some of them probably a little bit bigger, but they're all like Pluto on these crazy orbits that are elliptical, that are inclined, and that surround the solar system in this way. Pluto is much more reasonably called part of this outer region of the solar system, which we now call the Kuiper Belt, than it is part of that inner region of where the planets are. Let me show you the size of these objects in the Kuiper Belt. There's Pluto again. I'm going to add in now some of these Kuiper Belt objects, and you can see that if I put in the biggest ones, some of them are approaching the size of Pluto. One of them is almost exactly the same size as Pluto. This is Eris, one of the ones that I found. Most of the big ones are ones that we found in my surveys over the past couple of decades. But Pluto is not a particularly special member of this population. There's just huge numbers of these. Now, when people talk about whether Pluto should be a planet or not, and the debate can the debate doesn't much rage, but people still like to talk about it. I really just like to show this picture of the real sizes of the planets, and then I just, you know, drop the mic and walk off the stage. This really pretty much shows you why Pluto is not a planet. The planets are these big, massive objects that dominate the solar system, and then there are asteroids between Mars and Jupiter, tons of tiny asteroids, and tons of tiny Kuiper Belt objects on the outer part. People sometimes say to me, astronomers are mean and arbitrary for drawing the line at Pluto. And I agree, astronomers are mean, but they're not arbitrary. The place that astronomers drew the line is really obvious. It's very hard to look at the solar system and not decide that this is the right place to draw the line. An interesting thing happened, and in that survey that I was talking about where we found most of the big objects in the outer solar system, one of the objects that we found really was, I think, even at the time, I thought it was the most important scientific discovery that we found in this survey. And that was not one of these objects that's here in the middle part of the Kuiper Belt, but an object that was much, much further away. This object is called Sedna. It has this incredible property that while all the other objects in the Kuiper Belt are pretty close to Neptune, comparatively, this one never gets very close. And it has a very, very, very long elliptical looping orbit. It's very strange. It looks like that at some point in the past, Sedna was gently, or maybe not quite so gently, pulled from its orbit and pulled away from the central part of the solar system. When we first found Sedna, our explanation was probably the thing that pulled Sedna out was a star early on in the history of the solar system when the sun might have been formed with a lot of other stars nearby. A star got close and pulled Sedna out. And so we were kind of excited to find other objects like Sedna because that would start to let us look back at the sort of fossil record of the earliest history of the solar system, which is a pretty cool thing to be able to do. So we looked and we looked and we looked for about 10 years and we didn't find anything else quite like Sedna. until another group of astronomers found another object, which they called which is called 2012 VP 113. They nicknamed it Biden because it was VP and Biden was the vice president of the United States at the time. Astronomers are kind of crazy, but it is another thing. As you notice, it looks like it's been pulled out a little bit away from the sun. As soon as they found that, we started looking to see if there were other objects that we already knew about that were perhaps pulled out in different directions. And we realized that if you look at the solar system, there are 7 objects that are pulled away from the sun, and they all look like they're pulled in about the same direction. Not only that, if you tilt them on their side, they're all actually tilted up just a little bit. So you can imagine, it looks like something out in this direction is pulling all of those orbits in one way. It's a very strange thing, and we tried to understand what could possibly have done that. You cannot do this with a star a long time ago, like we had originally thought. If it was a star a long time ago, enough time has passed since then that all those things would now point in random directions. The only way to get those things all pointing in the same direction right now is if there's something tugging on them right now. And we sat down and did some calculations trying to understand what that might be and realized that we thought that this must be the signature of a giant planet, a truly giant planet, out there in the outer reaches of the solar system, pulling things along. And what we really thought, I will tell you, what we really thought at first was that a planet, to pull things off in this direction, a planet going around the sun, it's gonna have to be close up here and come far out here and loop down below us and come back up here again. So a very eccentric orbit looping off in the same direction. So to check that idea, we did some massive computer simulations, and let me show you how they work. We start out with many, many, many random objects. The sun is right here in the center. You can't even see the sun because all these things are in the way. Each one of these blue lines is the orbit of an object that's looping around the sun, and the sort of pink line is this massive planet that we put there to see what would happen if there was a massive planet out there. What we expected is that massive planet would pull things off in this direction towards me. And what we found, well, it's not happening. So they one thing that happens is that most of the objects go away over time, and in green are the close objects that are not affected, and in blue, the only objects that are left after all the time has gone by, and this is about 4 billion years, that you've been watching in super fast motion, the objects that are left are mostly over here, not over here. Anything that comes over here is quickly removed from the solar system. Anything that's over there sticks around. We were 180 degrees wrong in what we thought. We thought that a massive planet to pull objects in that direction, this is the end of 4 billion years, we thought to pull in objects in that direction, we needed a planet in that direction. It turns out we need a planet in this direction instead of in that direction. It's a very strange thing at first when we saw it. We thought this can't quite be right. But now it actually makes sense when we realize it. It's because if you think about how an orbit works, if the sun is here, an object, it spends a lot of time out here, and then it comes in and it's very fast as it goes through here, and slow again, very fast again. So if it's spending a lot of time out here, you don't want to ever be out here. Anything that comes out here where it's spending a lot of time quickly gets thrown out of the solar system. What you want to be is the exact opposite, where you almost never encounter the planet. And the reason you want to never encounter the planet is because this planet that we're talking about is 10 times the mass of the Earth. 10 times the mass of the Earth is almost the mass of Neptune. This is a real planet in the outer part of the solar system. This is something like 5,000 times more massive than Pluto, not just one of these little ice balls. So you never want to get close to that if you'd like to stick around. So if these are the objects, these are the real objects, and they're pointing off in this way, whoops, you're supposed to see, now I can't go back. Oh well, okay, you're supposed to see a video where the planet shows up and you see it, but the planet, you get the idea, the planet goes off in this direction. So How do we know that this is really there? Well, so I showed you one computer simulation. We've done around 3,000 different of these simulations with different parameters, putting the planet in different places, a slightly bigger planet, a slightly smaller planet. And what we found is that the only way we can reproduce what we really see in the solar system is by having something like a 5 to 20 Earth mass planet. We like to talk about it as about a 10 Earth mass planet, and there it is in comparison to Earth, Uranus, and Neptune. It's somewhere right in the middle of the mass range between Earth and Neptune, and about middle of the size. It's kind of an interesting thing, because when we say, hey, we think there's this 10 Earth mass planet out there, people say, great, what's it like? The answer is, the real answer is, we have no idea. And the reason we have no idea is because we don't have any planets like that in the solar system. We have terrestrial planets made out of rocks, which are all the mass of Earth and smaller. And then we have gas giants made of mostly gas, and those are from Uranus and larger. We don't have anything in the middle. Luckily, though, the solar system doesn't have anything in the middle, but the galaxy does. When we look all around the galaxy at all the other stars in the galaxy, we find many, many, many stars that have planets around them. And the most common type of planet has about 10 Earth masses, almost exactly like this. So finding a 10 Earth mass planet here in our solar system makes us more like the rest of the stars in the galaxy than we used to be. What we also know is that the 10 Earth mass planets in the galaxy tend to be gas giants. It's most likely that Planet 9 is a gas giant like that, rather than a big rock or a big ice ball, which would be a strange thing. Okay, the big question, of course, is how are we going to find it? We know it's there. We see its gravitational pull. And I say no, it's there. You know, you should really take anything that you haven't actually seen with a grain of salt. Our hypothesis is that it's there. I would say that our evidence is exceedingly strong. There is, in addition to just these objects that I'm showing you, there are about four or five other independent lines of evidence showing you that the planet is out there. If there is not a planet out there, then something is really funny going on in the outer part of the solar system that would be even stranger than a planet. I actually think having a planet out there is a pretty natural thing to exist, and having it explain these things is pretty easy to do. So what are we going to do? The way that we're going to find this planet is head out to some of the biggest telescopes in the world. This is the big volcanic summit of Mauna Kea on the island of Hawaii, and has many of the biggest, best telescopes in the world. And the telescopes that is the best telescope in the world for this is this one. This is the Subaru telescope. The Subaru is the Japanese national telescope, and the Japanese telescope has specialized in taking big pictures of the sky. And what we need to do is go back and be like Clyde Tombaugh and take big pictures of the sky and look for that thing that moves. The reason it can take big pictures of the sky is because they made this incredibly specialized camera. This is not a telescope, this is a camera that sits on the top of the telescope. The camera is bigger than an anime character, which is pretty amazing. And this camera is the biggest camera on a telescope in the world. This is the lens of the camera. This lens, the lens was built by Canon. This is the biggest compound lens ever built for any purpose in the world, and it sits on top of this telescope. And it's up here. I don't want that. It's up there. Here's the telescope. There's me and the other person I work with is Konstantin Batygin. He's never been to a telescope before. He does all the calculations. He's one of those theorists who you shouldn't let in the room with telescopes, but I let him up here anyway. And up at the very top, you can see that little tiny thing at the top is that huge camera. That huge camera takes these big pictures of the sky, bigger than any other pictures of the sky that have been taken. Okay, so we have the right camera, we have the right telescope. We kind of know, you know, from our simulations, we know where to look, but there's some things we don't know. So one thing we know really well is we know how the orbit is tilted. We know that it's tilted by about 20 degrees compared to the planets, and we also know which direction it's tilted. So if you think about that, what that really tells you is it tells you where in the sky you should look across the sky. It doesn't tell you the spot, but it tells you the swath of the sky to look in. So we now know the swath pretty well, and we've narrowed it down from looking at the whole sky to looking at about 5% of the sky because of the swath. The other thing that we know very well is this planet is so big that if it were close, we would have seen it already. So because it has this long looping orbit, if it were in the close part of the orbit, it would be so bright that you could see it. In fact, you could see it with some of the telescopes that people have in their backyards. You could see it, it's so bright. So we know that it has to be out on this part of the orbit, which means we also know where in the sky to look, when in the year to look. And the time to look is kind of amazing. This is a view that you might see if it were clear tonight, which I don't think it's going to be. But if it were clear tonight and you looked straight west right after sunset, you would see what I would say is the most recognizable constellation anywhere in the world, around the world. It's a constellation you can see from both hemispheres. It's the constellation that every culture has had some story about because it looks so human. And that's, of course, Orion, as we call it. Orion and the other constellation Taurus are, you know, if there's any constellation that someone knows, it's those. And to me, the most amazing thing is that this is about exactly where Planet Nine is right now. The swath of sky that we still have to look at to find it is about here. So it's not quite in Orion. Our first calculations put it right in the middle of Orion, which would have been fun, so it's not quite there. It's not quite in the middle of Orion, but it goes right across Taurus. This is the Taurus and the Pleiades there. It goes right across these, and it is in, as I said, one of the most recognizable places to put something in the sky. What I want you to do the next time it's actually clear, I don't know, is it ever clear? Can you guys see Orion from here? Or is it too bright? You can? Yes? Good. Okay. I couldn't see it last night. I checked. But I want you to do, next time it's clear, I want you to go out and I want you to look at the sky towards Orion, find Taurus, find the swath of the sky, and I want you to think about this. This is not abstract. This is real. There's a planet out there, and it's right in that area. And if you look closely enough, well, you can't see it. But if you look closely enough, you can feel like you can see it. You know it's really there, and you should just feel that there's this thing out there. People often ask me, when I start to talk about Planet Nine, one of the most common questions I get is, well, if there's a Planet Nine, is there a Planet 10? Is there a Planet 11? And the answer is why not? There was a stage at which we thought that 8 planets were all we were ever gonna get. And that was, you know, once Pluto was demoted, there were 8 planets and that's it. Now we realized that the giant planets of the solar system extend much further than we ever thought they did. And if there's a 9th planet, the same processes that put that 9th planet there very likely made a 10th and even possibly an 11th and a 12th. And the problem is, right now, Planet Nine is so far away and so faint that it takes these biggest telescopes in the world to find it. So we're not gonna find Planet 10 anytime soon. So Planet Nine, I'm pretty sure we will find in the next couple of years and you'll all get to hear about it, but Planets 10, 11, whatever else is out there is something that kids today are gonna be exploring when they grow up, when they become astronomers, when they build the new instruments that are the ones that are needed to find these, the new telescopes, the telescopes in space, the telescopes everywhere that are gonna be required to find these even more distant ones. So I find this not only exciting for the fact that we can go off and find this planet now and see what a new planet in the solar system is like, to find a new planet for the first time in 150 years, but for the idea that the exploration of the outer solar system is gonna continue on. And I just wanna to end with now, so I don't know if here people know as much about the movie Plan 9 from Outer Space. Has anyone ever heard of Plan 9 from Outer Space? Some of you have heard it. So in the United States, this is widely considered the worst movie ever made. Like really, go look it up on Wikipedia, Plan 9 from Outer Space. It'll say it's the worst movie ever made. So we stole the poster for Plan 9 from Outer Space and turned it into our own. But the most amazing thing about Plan 9 from Outer Space when we stole the poster. So the movie is, I can't even remember how it works. There's aliens and zombies and all kinds of strange things. And there's a scene in a graveyard that happens right here. But the most amazing thing about this movie poster from about 1965 or 50, I don't know when it is if you look down here at the graveyard scene, zoom in there really carefully, and it says, R.I.P. Pluto. Who knew? Even in 1960, they knew that this was really going to be the death of Pluto. That was a joke. See, you guys don't laugh at my jokes. I heard you guys. Thank you. It must be culturally appropriate. So I'm pretty excited about this. As you can tell, I'm excited about finding it. I'm excited about the future of studying it. I'm excited about what it tells for the next generations of astronomers out there. And so I will just leave you with stay tuned. I think we are within a year or two of finding this thing and telling it to the whole world. Thank you.